Welcome back to our lecture series, Math 1210, Calculus 1 for students at Southern Utah University. As usual, I'll be your professor today, Dr. Andrew Misseldine. And lecture 18, we're concluding our trilogy, which introduces us to the derivative. We've learned previously that the derivative is the limit of the difference quotient, and given a function, when it's differentiable, we can create a new function, which we call the derivative. That derivative can measure the slope of a tangent line associated to that function. It also measures the instantaneous rate of change, which has applications to things like velocity, acceleration, and many other problems we haven't even touched yet. In this video, and in the remaining part of lecture 18, I want to show you how the shape of the function affects the shape of the derivative and vice versa. That is, how are their shapes related to each other? Since the derivative measures the rate of change of f, we can determine the graph of f prime from the graph of g as illustrated in the following examples. We're going to do one of them in this example right here. So consider the function f, whose graph is given by like so, and the formula that produces this graph, who cares, don't know, I already forgot it. Deliberately giving you a function which would not be easy for the typical calculus student to look and find a formula. We're not going to do the derivative calculation algebraically, we're going to do it purely geometrically. So we're going to take the graph of f and draw the graph of f prime. So we begin by recognizing where the horizontal tangent lines are. These are going to be very important in our consideration, not just now, but in the future as well. The horizontal tangent lines, these are going to be the tangent lines to the function, which are completely flat. They have a derivative of zero, in which case on this graph, we can see three horizontal tangent lines like so. Some important significance to place upon these horizontal tangent lines. You'll notice that this tangent line corresponds to a minimum value on the graph. This one right here coincides to a maximum, and this one coincides with a minimum. In fact, if I were to put a little mark right here, then our function switched from decreasing to increasing, then increasing to decreasing. Sorry, excuse me. We went from decreasing to increasing like there. Then you switch from increasing to decreasing there, and then you switch from decreasing to increasing here. So these horizontal tangents seem to coincide with the changes in monotonicity of the graph. That's not a coincidence. We'll come and look at that a little bit more in the future in this lecture series. So if we just consider these points for right now, there's going to be a horizontal tangent line somewhere close to 1/2. Again, this isn't drawn perfectly, but we're just kind of making an estimate here. There seems to be another horizontal one around 1.5. So I'm going to put this right here. And then our last one, it seems to be on 4, you know, a little bit right there. Excuse me, on 3, x equals 3. And so we see that the horizontal tangent lines are going to coincide with around 1/2, 1.5, and 3. Why is this significant? Well, the slope of the tangent line is the derivative, right? The derivative measures that. So when we're at x equals 1/2, the tangent line slope is 0. Therefore, f prime at 1/2 should likewise be 0. That is, 1/2 is an x-intercept of the derivative. Likewise, if we look at 1.5, because the tangent slope is 0, the derivative should be 0. And likewise, the derivative at 3 should be 0 in this situation. So this is our first observation that I want to point out to you, that the location of the horizontal tangent lines gives us the x-intercepts of the derivative. Let's now focus more on this monotonicity I was mentioning earlier. So our function right here, when we're to the left of 1/2, we can see that the tangent line has a negative slope. We also mentioned that in this sector up to 1/2, the function was decreasing, right? It's only when you get past 1/2 before you hit 1.5, then the function, if you look at the tangent line there, the tangent line actually has a positive slope, and we see that the function was increasing. Then, coming over here to 3, if we look at another tangent line, the tangent line is going to have a negative slope again, in which case we see it's decreasing. And then once you get past 3, we see that the tangent line is going to be positive again. The function's actually increasing in that region there. So notice that if we just kind of summarize what we saw right here, our function was decreasing, then it was increasing, then it was decreasing again, and then it became increasing in the finale there. But with respect to the derivative, The derivative, when you look at the slope of that tangent line was negative. Then when you get past 1/2, but not quite to 1.5, the derivative had a was positive because the tangents are positive there. When we get between 1.5 and 3, the tangent lines are again decreasing. That is, the tangents have negative slope. The derivative is the slope of the tangent line, so it's going to be negative. And then finally, when you get past 3, you're over here, the tangent lines are going to be positive again. That is, the slope of the tangent line is going to be positive. So we see something like this. And so there's this correspondence that whenever the function's decreasing, the derivative is going to be negative. And whenever the function's increasing, the derivative is going to be positive. And so we can interpret that on our picture as well. And so let me take some of these things off the screen right there to help us see it a little bit better. So what we see is the following behavior, that going from this to the left right here, the function, it starts off with the tangent lines not very steep, it getting steeper, getting steeper, getting steeper, right? It gets steeper and steeper and steeper, but when I say steeper, I mean the absolute value of the slope is bigger. It's going to be negative. And so as we are to the left of 1/2, we're going to see a picture that looks something like this. That is, it's going off towards negative infinity. Because to the left, we have a negative slope, and the farther to the left of 1/2 we get, the more negative the slope's going to be. Well, how about between 1/2 and 1.5? Here, the slope's going to be positive. When you're really close to 1/2, it should be close to 0. When you're close to 1.5, it should also be really close to 0. But when you're in the middle, that tangent slope's going to be the steepest, about right there at x equals 1. It's where the tangent slope's going to be about the steepest. So there's going to be some type of, like, maximum value between 1/2 and 1.5. And so we see our function's going to go up and come down. Again, I don't have the exact calculations here. I'm just kind of trying to eyeball it a little bit. But we want to get an idea of what the graph of the derivative looks like just from this synopsis we're doing right now. So then as you go from 1.5 to 3, well, when you're close to 1.5, the slope is going to be small. That is, it'll be close to 0. Somewhere in the middle, it's going to get really steep, your tangent slope, and then it'll get back down to 0 when you get close to 3. So we're going to see the same type of behavior. It's going to be negative, so it's going to go down. Somewhere, you know, somewhere it's going to turn around and come back up. We see like so. And so again, you're going to see this local minimum somewhere in the middle between 1.5 and 3. Once you get past 3, we're going to start off with tangent lines which are not so steep, but they're going to get steeper and steeper and steeper the farther away from 3 you get. And so we see that our function's going to be positive, but it's going to be increasing as well. And so we get a picture that looks something like this, and this is the derivative of f when you compare the two side by side. My hand-drawn picture is not the best. Let me show you a computer-generated picture. So using the actual formula for f, we graphed it in yellow on the left. And then if you use the formula for the derivative of f, f prime, you graph that to the right, you'll see this is here. And that's actually pretty close to what I had drawn on the screen a little bit ago. And so we can infer the basic shape of the derivative from the shape of the function f. We will see later in this lecture series that this direction is in fact reversible. That the basic shape of the derivative, from it we can infer the basic shape of f. The two are very closely related to each other.